This week at NASA. October 7th is the launch date for SpaceX's Dragon spacecraft on the first commercial resupply mission to the International Space Station. This will be the first of 12 contracted flights by SpaceX to resupply the space station under the Commercial Resupply Services contract and will restore an American capability to transport cargo to and from the orbiting laboratory. Dragon will be sent aloft from Cape Canaveral Air Force Station in Florida by SpaceX's Falcon 9 rocket. A backup launch opportunity is available on October 8th.
Hello, my name is Sanjeev Gupta, and I'm a long-term planner for the Mars Curiosity rover. This is your Curiosity rover update. We've now been on Mars for almost 2 months, and we've been witnessing the amazing new vistas of the never-before-seen Gala landscape taken with our wonderful cameras. However, much of the science team have had their eyes and the rover's eyes firmly focused on the ground. On the drive from the Bradbury landing site to our current location, we have been analysing three really interesting outcrops that we have called Goulburn, Link and Hotter. If we look at the Hotter outcrop, we can see a distinct layer that has been tilted and eroded, and this allows us to look at the cross-section through the layer. When we looked at the layer with our high-resolution MarsCam camera, we found that it was comprised of sand grains and small pebbles that had become cemented to form a hard layer. Here, you can see a pebble that is 3 centimeters in diameter, so smaller than a ping pong ball. This suggests that this layer is an ancient gravel deposit. The surprising thing is that when we looked at the pebbles closely, we discovered that many of them were quite well rounded. This is very different to the many angular clasts that usually litter the Martian surface. Here, you can see a rounded pebble from a riverbed on Earth. On Earth, rounded pebbles are a common telltale sign of rocks that have been transported by water, for example, in a river or stream. As water flows over a riverbed, if the flow strength is great enough, the pebbles are lifted up into the flow or rolled along the riverbed, and they become pounded and battered against each other, and this causes them to become rounded through time. So what we think we might be seeing here on Mars is an ancient riverbed with the pebble beds representing old stream deposits. The size of the pebbles tells us that these rocks could not have been transported by the wind, so it seems clear they must have been transported by water. So how did this pebble deposit get to be here? If we look more broadly in Gale Crater, we can see that there is a prominent feature that geologists call an alluvial fan. Alluvial fans are cone-shaped deposits of gravel and sand that accumulate where streams exit mountains. In Gale Crater, there is a 10-kilometer long fan formed at the mouth of a 30-meter deep canyon that is derived from the crater rim. On the fan itself, we can see evidence for multiple channels suggesting that the stream bed direction changed through time. When we look at the location of the Curiosity landing site with respect to the alluvial fan, we see that the rover landed downstream of the fan. The rounded pebbles likely represent long-distance transport down the alluvial fan. So this is really exciting news for the science team because it's the first time we are seeing gravel transported by water on the surface of Mars. This has been another exhilarating week for Curiosity on Mars and for the science team here in Pasadena. This has been your Curiosity rover report. Check back for more updates.
The next crew slated to live aboard the International Space Station continues to ready itself for the mission. Expedition 3334 Soyuz Commander Oleg Novitsky of the Russian Federal Space Agency, NASA Flight Engineer Kevin Ford, and Russian Flight Engineer Evgeny Tarelkin took a break from training to field questions from the news media at the Gagarin Cosmonaut Training Center in Star City, Russia. They also participated in traditional ceremonies in Moscow's Red Square. The trio will ride a Soyuz spacecraft to the ISS in mid-October, where they'll join Expedition 33 Commander Sonny Williams of NASA, Flight Engineer Aki Hoshide of the Japan Aerospace Exploration Agency, and Russian Flight Engineer Yuri Malenchenko. Space Shuttle Endeavour is back on the ground following its removal from NASA 905, the shuttle carrier aircraft that transported Endeavour from Kennedy Space Center to Los Angeles International Airport. Following its demating from the modified 747, Endeavour was moved into a United Airlines hangar, where it will be prepped for its two-day journey through the streets of Inglewood in Los Angeles to its new home at the California Science Center. Endeavour, the youngest of NASA's 5 space shuttles, was rolled out of the Palmdale, California assembly plant in April 1991 and flew the first of its 25 missions the next year. Astronomers compiled 10 years' worth of photographs taken by NASA's Hubble Space Telescope to make the Extreme Deep Field, or XDF, the deepest image ever taken of our universe. It builds on the work done in the 2003 timeframe when the Ultra Deep Field image revealed distant galaxies that offer clues into the earliest times of the universe. The XDF is a small patch of sky that reveals about 5,000 galaxies, but is only a fraction of the entire universe. It gives us a glimpse of galaxies about 450 million years after the Big Bang. The Goddard Space Flight Center recently took delivery of the first two of 18 beryllium primary mirror segments for NASA's James Webb Space Telescope. Ball Aerospace in Boulder, Colorado shipped the two mirrors in custom containers. The remaining 16 mirrors will likewise make their way from Boulder to Goddard over the next 12 months and will be integrated into the telescope in 2015. The Webb, NASA's next great observatory, is on track for launch in October 2018. This artist's illustration, based in part on data from NASA's Chandra X-ray Observatory, indicates that our Milky Way galaxy is surrounded by an enormous halo of hot gas. Extending hundreds of thousands of light years, this hot gas halo has a mass comparable to that of all the stars in the Milky Way, and a temperature much hotter than previously believed. The illustration shows the halo in blue, along with the Milky Way and two neighboring galaxies, the small and large Magellanic Clouds.
Welcome to the Kennedy Space Center's 50th Anniversary Gala.
The Kennedy Space Center and the National Space Club Florida Committee marked KSC's 50th anniversary with a gala in the visitor complex's Apollo Saturn V Center. With celebrating the past and preparing for the future as their theme, some 650 current and former NASA employees, dignitaries, and guests noted Kennedy's achievements of the last five decades while discussing the center's next chapter as a hub of commercial spaceflight.
The Kennedy Space Center is synonymous with humankind's greatest achievements in exploration of the universe. Kennedy and its adjacent Cape Canaveral sites were the launch pads for Alan Shepard's first flight, John Glenn's first orbit of Earth, and Neil Armstrong's first small step.
Throughout those 50 years, there's been one common theme, and that's an insatiable desire to explore, to send humans and robotic spacecraft beyond the confines of our home planet.
More than 1,700 people got an inside peek at the programs and projects at Marshall Space Flight Center during its Innovation and Technology Day. The event included a technology expo with more than 70 booths of interactive displays, exhibits, and demonstrations showcasing the latest trends and initiatives in the areas of information technology, engineering, science programs, and projects. Innovation and Technology Day was hosted by Marshall's Chief Information Officer and the Office of Strategic Analysis and Communications. The Moon took center stage for stargazers around the world during International Observe the Moon Night. Ames was one of the NASA centers hosting events. Astronomers with NASA's Lunar Science Institute held discussions and presentations, while amateur astronomers and astronomy clubs set up telescopes for public viewing. The moon appeared as half full in what is known as a first quarter moon, which is ideal for viewing. Sputnik 1, the first artificial Earth satellite, was launched into an elliptical low Earth orbit by the Soviet Union 55 years ago on October 4, 1957. The surprise launch precipitated the American Sputnik crisis, began the space age, and triggered the space race, a part of the larger Cold War. Sputnik was also scientifically valuable. The density of the upper atmosphere could be deduced from its drag on the orbit, and its radio signals, monitored by amateur radio operators worldwide, gave information about the ionosphere. After about 37 million miles and 3 months in orbit, Sputnik 1 fell back to Earth and burned up in the atmosphere on January 4, 1958.
I have liftoff, watch it started.
50 years ago, on October 3, 1962, NASA astronaut Wally Schirra orbited the Earth six times in the Sigma 7 spacecraft. The Mercury Atlas 8 mission was the fifth United States manned space mission. The 9-hour flight focused mainly on technical evaluation and was the longest U.S. manned orbital flight to date in the space race. The flight confirmed the Mercury spacecraft's durability ahead of Gordon Cooper's one-day Mercury Atlas IX mission the next year. Langley Research Center Director Lisa Rowe accepted a Bridge Builder Award on behalf of NASA during the Virginia Hispanic Chamber of Commerce's annual Hispanic Gala. The award recognizes Langley's efforts to improve the connection between the Hispanic community and the community at large, and its contributions to inspire Hispanic youth via STEM educational outreach efforts in Virginia and throughout the country. Also presented with a Bridge Builder Award was Secretary of Labor Hilda Solis, who is the first Hispanic woman to serve as a United States cabinet member.
No matter where you come from, no matter what zip code, no matter what side of the aisle or even railroad, what side of the tracks you were born on, there are great possibilities in this country.
And that's This Week at NASA. For more on these and other stories, or to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and other social media, log on to www.nasa.gov.